The 1967 festival was most important for the emergence of Tropicália, a brand new movement determined to transform Brazilian music. It was headed by Gilberto Gil and Caetano Veloso, two friends who'd moved to Rio from the northern city of Salvador, but aimed to break what they saw as the stranglehold of Rio on Brazilian music. They were opposed to the military dictatorship, of course, but also opposed to what they saw as the dogmatic elitism of the left. They planned to create a new, distinctively Brazilian style by mixing rock music from the West with different styles from right across Brazil. Gilberto Gil was deliberately provocative, working with a rock band, Os Mutantes, who used electric guitars, hated by the left, for the first time at a song festival on Domingo no Parque. Caetano Veloso was also controversial. He upset left-wingers who thought his song, Alegria, Alegria, sounded too American, though it became such a success that he acquired pop star status.
The main aim of tropicalism was really shake the environment, the musical and cultural environment. This small group from Bahia thought that violence of our situation and the importance of mass culture had a lot in common, you know, political violence and pop icons, you know. It had to do with rock and roll. That's why we liked the Beatles, because they loved what had been up to that moment just commercial rubbish.
With rock and roll and with the, you know, pop music, with the Beatles and everything, we thought that we should just be sounding national, sounding Brazilian, but sounding global as well. Because of the dictatorship, we needed a strong reaction from the society in terms of enduring for freedom, for liberty, for freedom of speech, for circulation of ideas. Eu organizo o movimento, eu oriento o carnaval, inauguro o
movimento no Planalto Central do país. The Tropicália movement included Gal Costa and Tom Zé, also from Bahia, along with poets, film directors and artists, all determined to create a new Brazilian style. Their philosophy involved cultural cannibalism, devouring different influences to create a new style. Those influences included Western pop, represented by the Beatles, pop art, the glamour and kitsch of Brazil's Hollywood star of the 40s, Carmen Miranda, music from the Brazilian regions, from the country songs of Luiz Gonzaga to Bahia's Dorival Caymmi, and the classic samba of Paulinho da Viola, who sometimes appeared at Tropicália events, as did yet another major Tropicália hero and influence, the songwriter Jorge Ben.
He was the embryo of the very thing we were trying to do consciously. He had started with bossa nova and he had added rhythm and blues and rock and roll to his thing, and he had a new synthesis that prefigured everything the tropicalistas wanted to do.
Matar o meu amor e matei às 5 horas na Avenida Central.
das pessoas na sala de jantar são ocupadas em...
The Tropicália movement also had its own rock band, Os Mutantes, who later developed cult status in the West.
We shot arrows everywhere, no aim. we were basically just having fun, and we were kids, and we just wanted to play rock and roll.
Os Mutantes were amazing because they were very young, and you know, we were beginning to love rock and roll through the Beatles, and they sounded to me at the time not an imitation of the Beatles. They sounded like something almost just as creative in the same in the same line, you know.
Playing exactly what the Beatles did. we thought we were playing rock and roll, you know. I think Brazil is such a kaleidoscope of information, especially then. There was no information, so we used to pick up music from, thanks to BBC, via the short waves. And we used to get the Beatles, you know, and all those cats, because there was nothing available. And so it was very hard to really understand what was going on. So we painted it the way we saw it.
Tropicália upset the military, the left, and survivors from the Bossa Nova movement, who regarded these newcomers as decidedly inferior.
But I don't think there is a blossoming of culture like in Bossa Nova. I don't call Bossa Nova a movement, because there was no manifest, there was no intention. Everything was very spontaneous. But Tropicália was a movement. They had a manifest. They had an idea in their heads. But the idea of Tropicália never won anything, never went too far.
The left-wing artists and critics, they reacted against us. They thought we were selling out, becoming commercial, and approving the American imperialism through admitting mass culture, rock and roll, counterculture, and all of this stuff, you know, Hollywood.
So where did Tropicália find an audience? Tom Zay argued that its followers came from a quite different section of Brazilian society, who were open to new ideas.
Então, nós podemos dizer que tinha três tipos de pessoas: a direita, a esquerda e as pessoas que estavam inocentemente capazes de ser conquistada pela estética, pela curiosidade, pela novidade. Essa terceira classe de pessoas foi muito importante, porque foi ela que comprou o disco, foi ela que deu audiência aos programas.
Timing was right for a new, internationally influenced musical movement. 1968 was a year of global upheavals, and rock music provided the soundtrack. In communist Czechoslovakia, Soviet tanks rolled in to end Dubček's experiment in socialism with a human face. In Britain, as in America, there were violent protests against the Vietnam War. In France, student clashes with the police escalated into serious riots and even fears that the state itself was under threat. While in Brazil, there was also increasing chaos. The soldiers had originally promised that they would relinquish power in 1967, but they stayed on, with military hardliners determined to crack down on any form of opposition. On June 26, 1968, a mass demonstration, the March of 100,000, was held in Rio, organized in protest at the killing of a student shot by police. Caetano Veloso, Gilberto Gil, Chico Buarque, Edu Lobo, Paulinho de Viola and Milton Nascimento were among the musicians who took part.
Os estudantes organizaram a marcha dos 100 mil de protesto. Foi, eu estava acho que na primeira fila dessa marcha e foi uma coisa assim que me emocionava, como emocionou a todo mundo. E foi difícil, mas foi bonito, porque eu, por exemplo, não tinha visto até então o Brasil, tanta gente reunida pela mesma causa.
A song by Caetano Veloso expressed the anger of the times and became a Tropicália anthem, a proibido proibir, prohibiting is prohibited, a slogan taken from the student upheavals in France. The footage of him singing the song at the 1968 TV Globo Song Festival has been destroyed, but a sound recording still exists of Veloso attacking the audience for their musical conservatism. In December 1968, the confrontation between soldiers and protesters entered a new phase. The military government published AI-5, Institutional Act No. 5, which suspended habeas corpus, allowing houses to be searched without a warrant and anyone to be jailed without a reason being given. Torture became commonplace and thousands simply disappeared. The military didn't arrest left-wing musicians, but instead targeted the leaders of Tropicália, Caetano Veloso and Gilberto Gil.
What scared and what bothered the military was basically behavior, you know? The way, I mean, we were sort of dressing and manifesting and dealing ideas, you know, trading ideas, that sort of thing. The behaviorist revolutionary element.
On December the 27th, 1968, Gil and Veloso were detained in Sao Paulo and driven to Rio, where they were held without charge.
I didn't think they would put us in prison, you know. They told us the military authorities want to talk to you, to ask you some questions. And I thought they were going to ask us, why did you join the parades? Why did you do this or that? What does this mean? And I thought I would be able to answer all those questions without having problems, because we joined the parades, but lots of other artists in Brazil did so. Very well known with photographs, and they were, you know, hand in hand with us, you know, and they were not being put in jail.
I was anxious to be out of that. I was a little depressed. I was a little concerned about my future. I was a little worried. I took it very personally. I had no time in prison to sort of think, okay, when we out of here, we should sort of connect, or we should sort of use this thing as a political background to make the movement grow or something like that. I was not political at all. I mean, being in prison, I was totally human.
The two singers were questioned and told they were considered more dangerous than those involved in straightforward political activity. After 2 months in jail, they were taken back to their home state, Bahia.
They brought us to Bahia and we stayed here for 4 months. We could not leave the town and we had to report every day to a colonel. And after that, they invited us to leave the country and we decided to live in London.
I'm wandering round and round, nowhere to go. I'm lonely, London, London's lovely soul. I cross the streets without fear, everybody keeps the way clear. I know no one here to say hello.
Gilles and Veloso arrived in London as exiles in 1969 and stayed for over 2 years. They became actively involved in the London music scene, and they both wrote and recorded in English. Caetano even praised the London police.
A group approached a policeman. He seemed so pleased to please them. It's good at least to live, and I agree.
In London, it was peaceful. No policeman would, you know, harass you in the streets. And music was very interesting. You know, that's where things were happening. You know, we knew, we loved the Beatles from here and the Rolling Stones, and we knew about, you know, Pink Floyd. We had heard Pink Floyd, other things, you know.
Pop rock, British, especially Beatles and Stones and Traffic.
You are the reason I've been waiting so long. Somebody holds the key. Well, I'm near the end and I just ain't got the time. Well, I'm wasted and I can't find my way.
And the reggae, the West Indian scene, sort of starting in Notting Hill, we caught the first moments of that thing happening.
So it was the right place to be. But still, first year I was mostly depressed.
Leave your mind at home.
Even so, Veloso and Gilles made the most of their time in exile. In 1970, they were among the crowds at the Isle of Wight Festival, where they were invited to make an impromptu appearance, accompanied by a group of naked friends draped in red plastic.
We saw everybody who played there, from Bob Dylan one year to Johnny Mitchell and Jimi Hendrix. In fact, we sang. It was very funny. Somebody saw us and they invited us to sing one of those afternoons.
Já faz três noites.
In 1972, the Brazilian authorities finally allowed Veloso and Gilles to return to stay. By the following year, they were both on stage at a festival in Sao Paulo, where Caetano Veloso sang an experimental version of a song by the Tropicália hero from the Brazilian northeast, Luiz Gonzaga.
sertão. Ai, ai, eu vou me embora, vou cuidar da plantação. Já bateu asas e voltou pro meu sertão.
We did come back because the authorities had made clear that we were not going to be bothered. But there was censorship. It was still the military government.
Concerts and recordings were only allowed if the songs had been cleared in advance by the military censorship board. At the Sao Paulo festival, Gilberto Gil joined with Chico Buarque, who'd spent a year in Italy and returned as a favorite target for the censors. They sang a deliberately mumbled version of Calice, a Buarque song that had been banned and which played on the similarities in the Portuguese words for goblet and shut up in order to attack military oppression.
Calice, 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 pai, afasta de mim esse calice.
As they were singing, Chico Buarque's microphone was suddenly turned off.
Alô? Alô, alô, alô.
Every major songwriter in Brazil now faced censorship.
It was really a very hard time to be a songwriter. On the other hand, it was a very interesting time too, because people had to find creative ways to fool the guys, you know, and they did. We all did. We became like the metaphor kings and queens, you know. Oh, everybody wrote metaphorically. Other people did it better than I did, like Chico Buarque, he was the best. And then they were totally scared about him.
Moro num país tropical, abençoado por Deus e bonito por natureza.
But for those with money, life in the military era was good. This was a time of repression, but also a boom period for the Brazilian economy. There was a growing gap between rich and poor. But for many Brazilians, this was still the country blessed by God, celebrated by Jorge Ben and his cheerful anthem, País Tropical. And yet, amazingly, even this song was censored.
País Tropical, eu fui chamado porque na época eles pensaram que eu estava mandando alguma mensagem para os... O pessoal, não terrorista, não era terrorista, o pessoal que fazia guerrilha no Brasil. Quando eu cortei as mó num pá, propi, abençoar por de e boni por nature. Eles pensavam que esse era um código que eu estava mandando para os. Mas eu não, eu estava inventando uma maneira de cantar, né?